harness match the village with color. Through it, the Enderberry people move and blend their own personal fashion and their curiously graceful figures within a world entirely of their own making. Busy themselves with their household chores and in such preoccupations as weaving and lacing the decorative reed mats they use in lieu of beds and furnishings in their huts. They have in common with the Europeans. For instance, the children play games familiar with trifling variations all over the world. Considerable complexity as a speciality with them. Like their European contemporaries, the Enderberry females consider that most things, no matter how plain or tough, can be improved by a bit of camouflage. So even the dishes in which they feed their men, let alone the charms by which they catch them, are ornately decorated with beadwork. Their own persons are lavishly dressed in designs of intriguing patterns, and their bangles and necklaces have a charm calculated to enhance the appearance of even a European beauty. Even the most cursory visit to a Bantu village reveals the people as being widely different from the European in habit and mode of life. Though they may have much which is familiar, the young folk romance and the old folk gossip, there are still so many differences that the question must arise, who are these people? Where do they come from? What are their origins? This presents an intriguing channel of investigation into the oft-times obscure but always fascinating tangle of mankind's beginnings. The beginnings of the Bantu, actually, are neither remote nor unduly complicated. Generally, it is supposed that their birthplace was far up in the region of the Great Lakes of Central Africa. From this nursery in the heart of the Dark Continent, they migrated southwards in successive waves. As they travelled and separated, they acquired the distinctive characteristics which each tribal group possesses today. One such group were the people who now live on the mountainous roof of South Africa, the Basuto of Basutoland. They took refuge here in the fastness of the highest mountains. They brought with them some of their own peculiar fashions and acquired others in the course of the years, eventually developed into one of the most picturesque Bantu tribes of today. Their straw hats and gaily patterned blankets are worn by no other tribe in all Africa. Either the Sotho, these patterns are worn with a grace and naturalness completely suited to their own environment. Likewise, their horsemanship is distinctive, for the Bantu on the whole are foot sloggers, born and bred, and it is only the Basutu who have become black cavalieros on a large scale. And like all similar horse users, they have become particularly good at that deft and complex skill, the horse trade. The land of the Basutu is a fertile and beautiful place of green fields and giant cloud castles. In it, the Basutu lead the life of all Bantu, the men working as little as possible, and the boys in the fields all day in the sun and the wind, caring for their father's flocks and herds, filing away the hours, playing the peculiarly mournful yet attractive instrument they call the receiver. If the men are somewhat evasive as far as work is concerned, it is only because they've got the women properly trained. The Basutu women are lively and energetic. Besides the daily chores, their skillful hands turn out the clay pots, which are at once so functional and decorative. They model all manner of novel figures and curios as well, although some of the men, notably Samuel Makwanyane, have produced clay models of superb perfection, like these tiny figures of the Sotho people, women and children, reapers, workers, all made out of the self-same clay as the pots and vases destined to be used for cookery and ornaments. Another great migratory wave brought down the people who now inhabit the Transkei territory. They are the Khoisas, the Pondos, Tembus, and others. They wandered southwards, seeking refuge from the Zulu Impis, and eventually came into contact with the white settlers moving northwards. Today, their territory lies between Durban and East London. Like the Basutu, the Transkei Bantu developed their own passions and habits. Red is the favorite color of these people, and with their ochre-daubed faces, long pipes, their red blankets, and the magnificent landscape of their homeland, they provide a colorful and unusual addition to the mixed batch of humanity inhabiting the face of Africa. There has always been, in some ways, a greater affinity towards the sea among the Transkei people than among any other of the Bantu. They have for long developed a taste for the periwinkles and shellfish, which their women collect along the rugged coast. I'm sorry. the most important migration groups brought down to southern Africa, among others, were the Swazis and the Zulus. It was in the 17th century that they first entered their present homeland north of Durban, and there among its mountains, waterfalls and bush, they established themselves. Like all the Bantu, the Swazi have their vanities. These young Swazi gallants, doing their toilet beneath the white slurry of the Poponyane Falls, are dressed in the height of fashion. Gaily coloured silk and cotton robes, beads, feathers and necklaces, and always with a little mirror in which to view their persons. Sing a For hours they sit beside some passing stream and titivate their hair, soaking and re-soaping until the carbonic acid in the soap bleaches the colour of the hair to a hue as blonde as ever peroxide brought a European dark hair. These young Swazis have some purpose behind all their toilets. They are going courting, not for themselves, that would be contrary to convention, but on behalf of a friend. Beneath an acacia tree they meet the goat. Poor young things they are, most skilled in all the charms of their sex. Their European young lady contemporaries, it is true, might have the benefit of going to schools and finishing academies, where they learn all the arts except the only one most of them ever intend to use. But these Swazi lovelies know not the distractions of mathematics or grammar. They can add up the score and say yes without any schooling, save that of courtship. And who can say if they are the less happy for it? They are most accomplished performers as well on the single-string Swazi instrument, the Mkuyuani, whose note so often rises and falls in the warm Swazi air. Bantu women, being so well under control, just shyly follow behind when the nobler sex start out on the journey. If there was any baggage, it would be packed on the female heads as well. The whole process, indeed, providing a classic example of women being led up a particularly beautiful garden path. It is a jumble of scenic marvels, cloaked in a tangle of trees and bush, threaded with the romantic pathways, trampled over the face of Africa by the restless feet of mankind. So this procession of young Swazis with affectionate intentions reaches their village in the wilderness. There they sit against the reed screen of a hut and discuss such details of courtship and marriage as will end in a Bantu wedding of complicated and absorbing ceremony and hurry. Let us leave the Swazis to their courtship, for it's a lengthy and wordy affair, hidebound by set conventions. Let us move off to Zululand to witness the last day in the spectacular Zulu wedding ceremony. The martial Zulu people, the best known of all the Bantu tribes, are closely related to the Swazi. They migrated down with them from the north at the same time back in the 17th century and settled in the beautiful maze of 10,000 hills and 1,000 rivers, which is Zululand. Here a Zulu bride and her retinue of bridesmaids are making their way to the village of her bridegroom. The ritual of courtship and marriage is over. The bride price, or lobola, has been paid by the bridegroom to the father of the bride. Extra presents of jokes and finery have been sent to the bride to lure her away from the home of her father and overcome, in Bantu fashion, their stimulated coyness, which comes to all women when they know that they have securely got their man.
Hilltop, right to west of the